This week, we're going to tackle some common questions that just keep coming up over and over again. So let's try to get some actual answers. Vámonos. It's a very common idea. Seems like there's a study out there for every possible position. So I guess every opinion's worth the same and everything's meaningless, so I'll just eat whatever I want. Of course, that's based on a misunderstanding. Nutrition science is not decided by individual studies in a vacuum. I actually just recorded a podcast where I discussed this exact topic with the host at length. So I'll add a link to the description below if you want to check it out. The bottom line is we got to look at all the evidence, what we call the preponderance of the evidence in nerd speak, to be able to see the trends, to see where the errors are generally pointing to. That's how the experts come up with the guidelines. They have to go over hundreds, thousands of studies. They don't pluck out one study randomly from the literature and then they all disagree and they all battle to the death or something. Although that would be a lot more fun to watch. If this is a little confusing, if it's not quite making sense, here's an example. During the 20th century, when scientists were studying tobacco and lung cancer, the vast majority of studies showed a link, but a couple didn't. So does that mean that tobacco and lung cancer is still a controversial topic? That any opinion's valid? No. It means that when you run 1,000 studies, some are not going to be statistically significant. That's just inherent to the variability. Maybe they didn't have enough people, maybe they didn't follow them long enough. There's 1,000 explanations. The bottom line is, we need to look at all the evidence to be able to see the trends, not pluck out one observation and extrapolate. Make sense? Next. If we go by media headlines, it does look like that sometimes. But that's how they get their clicks. If the headline was, scientists agree, broccoli is a really healthy food, nobody's reading that. It's not surprising. So the newsmakers have to look for shock value. Cancer linked to Brussels sprouts. Your coffee may be giving you Alzheimer's. Or their absolute favorite, new study shows everything you thought you knew about X is wrong. That's not science. That's salesmanship. The flashy headline, that's what spreads like wildfire. The correction, the nuance, the clarification, nobody cares. So the truth is, nutrition experts are in agreement on 95%, and nutrition advice doesn't change that much. A little bit here and there as we learn more, but not fundamentally. The fundamentals have been essentially the same for years, and actually, a lot of it for decades. Saturated fat raises our cholesterol levels and our risk of heart disease. That's established, and I've made videos covering that in detail. Now, a few years ago, a couple studies came out that claimed saturated fat made no difference. Obviously, the media jumped all over it, and that created a lot of confusion. Bottom line is, saturated fat raises your risk of heart disease, but it's not the only food that does it. So it depends what you replace it with. If you lower your saturated fat and you eat more fruits and vegetables, yeah, your risk of heart disease is going to come down. But if you swap your saturated fat for Twinkies, you're not going to see a benefit. They're both bad. So any study that doesn't make that distinction and just lumps everything together can be misleading. When that distinction is made, the difference is clear. So bottom line is, we do want to go easy on the saturated fat, but we want to replace it with healthy food, not other bad stuff. Make sense? Next. There's nothing special about eggs. There's nothing fundamentally different. They're an animal source food, so they're going to be relatively high in cholesterol and saturated fat. Now, there's nothing in eggs that we can't get somewhere else, so we definitely don't need them. But that fact alone doesn't necessarily tell us that they're bad. So, are they good or bad? Well, it depends what you compare them to. It's just like saturated fat. They're not the healthiest food out there by any stretch of the imagination. They're not the best breakfast option, but they're also not the worst. So if we're talking oatmeal and fruit, yeah, that's going to be more health promoting. But if we're talking sausage and bacon, you're probably better off eating your eggs, to be honest. The amount, the frequency also plays an important role. If you eat eggs once or twice a month, that's not going to be a big deal physiologically because your body has time to rectify the peak of cholesterol and whatever else goes up. But if you eat eggs 3 times a day, that's a whole different story. So everything in nutrition is relative. It depends on your goals and your risk tolerance. The short answer is yes. Studies have clearly shown that effect. But the exact magnitude, the exact size of the effect varies from person to person, just like anything else. Now, there are some studies out there funded by the egg industry that have a lot of people confused. One trick they use is they look at people who already have very high blood cholesterol levels from the get-go. So adding one more extra egg on top doesn't make much of a difference. This led to this general idea you see sometimes out there in the blogosphere that the cholesterol you eat has nothing to do with your blood cholesterol levels. That's smoke and mirrors. Eating cholesterol raises your blood cholesterol. up to a high level where it starts to plateau, it starts to level off. But you don't want to be in those ranges anyway. By the way, saturated fat does the exact same thing, but even stronger than dietary cholesterol. So the more saturated fat you eat, the higher your blood cholesterol level, up to that very high range where it starts to level off. So the truth is, if you have a cholesterol issue, then cutting back on the eggs and other animal foods that are rich in cholesterol and saturated fat helps. The experts are in agreement that raising our HDL, what people call our good cholesterol, doesn't really help, doesn't lower our risk of heart disease. I've made videos on this before going over the details. So a food that raises both your bad cholesterol, your LDL, and your good cholesterol, your HDL, is just bad news. So we want to go easy on those. I used to have this exact same question, and I actually ate meat most of my life, into my 30s. The truth is, we don't. We can be very healthy without meat, or even any animal product. At the same time, if I choose to eat some animal products, that doesn't automatically mean I'm unhealthy. It depends on a number of factors. The type, the amount, the frequency, my genetics, other lifestyle factors, etc. Some people can get away with more than others. That's life. So it's a choice. Don't let anybody tell you that you need to eat meat, otherwise you'll wither away and you'll crumble to dust and your limbs will fall off. There's no science behind that. There's no nutrient in meat that we can't find somewhere else. We'll talk more about risks in a minute, but it is absolutely a choice. Protein is everywhere. Every animal food has protein. Every plant has protein. I've made several videos covering protein requirements and amino acids and all this stuff in detail. So unless you're in a very specific situation, like very old person, frail, with impaired appetite, or if you're starving, you're just not getting enough calories, unless you're in a very specific class like that, you're getting more protein than you need, whether you choose to eat animal products or not. The vast majority of people in our society get more protein than they need. It's just not a concern. It's ironic that we're all running around yanking our hair out, worrying about protein. Am I getting enough protein? Where do you get your protein? Truth is, it's one of the nutrients you need to worry the least about. As long as you eat enough calories, you're getting enough protein. It's that simple. Same goes for amino acids, by the way. You don't need to worry about combining any special foods. You can get all the amino acids you need from plants or from animals. Your call. If you choose to avoid animal products, just make sure you're eating a variety of plants, as unprocessed as possible, ideally whole plants, from all the groups, legumes, whole grains, nuts and seeds, fruits and vegetables, and you're going to get all the protein you need and all the amino acids you need. No need to worry. Same with calcium. You can get it from animal products, like dairy, or you can get it from plants. Your call. In fact, some of the richest sources of calcium are plants. Things like kale, collard greens, they have more calcium than milk, and it's actually more bioavailable, more absorbable. So if you eat dairy, that's going to give you plenty of calcium. If you're somebody who's avoiding animal foods, just make sure you're eating a variety of plants, ideally unprocessed whole plants, and have some leafy greens in there, things like kale, collard greens. You're going to get all the calcium you need. Exact same thing with iron. Surprise, surprise. You can get it from animals or plants. Plenty of iron in both. Now, there are some things we need to be aware of on each side. People who eat animal products, they should be aware of heme iron. About 40% of the iron in red meat, for example, is heme iron. Heme iron is a prooxidant that's been linked to a number of diseases like heart disease, diabetes, and some types of cancer. So just be aware of that and don't lean too hard on the heme iron-rich foods. On the other hand, if you don't eat animal products, you need to be aware of absorption, especially if you're a woman. Women need more iron than men. Iron is in all types of plants, legumes, grains, greens, seeds, chia seeds, and sesame seeds have a ton. Try to have some source of vitamin C with your meals, like fruits or vegetables. It increases absorption of non-heme iron. And avoid tea and coffee during meals. Also, onion and garlic help with absorption of non-heme iron as well. Now, if you're a vegetarian, you should be aware that eggs and dairy are not good sources of iron, so you're actually going to be getting most of your iron from the plant foods. So, bottom line, you can get plenty of iron from animal foods or plant foods, your call. Just be aware on the caveats on each side and play with that. All right, next. They can be extremely healthy lifestyles. We all understand that just because somebody is a vegetarian or a vegan doesn't automatically mean they're healthy. It also doesn't automatically mean they're deficient in any nutrient either. Those are misconceptions. As long as you're eating a variety of unprocessed plants of all groups, you're going easy on the vegan junk food and all that processed stuff, and you're covering some basics like B12, yes, there can be an extremely healthy lifestyle. No, you're not going to be deficient in any nutrients, and you may be at lower risk for some common diseases like heart disease, diabetes, and Alzheimer's, for example. If you don't eat animal products, you need to be aware of B12. Even if you eat animal products, you should still be aware of it. B12 deficiency is surprisingly common, even among people who eat animal products, especially above a certain age. There's three basic sources of B12: animal foods, fortified foods, and supplements. And they're all equally effective. They all get you more B12 than you need. It's a personal choice. I know, if you're watching the headlines, it can seem sometimes like scientists hate meat or they have something personal against it. It's nothing personal. Truth is, the majority of scientists eat meat. It's not like they're sitting there plotting ways to trash animal products. It's just that red flags keep coming up over and over. Cholesterol, saturated fat, heme iron, we've talked about those. More recently, something called TMAO, and there's many others. So the science just keeps revealing new risks associated with consumption of animal foods. Now, it's impossible to tell somebody specific, you can eat these many steaks and these many eggs before it's a problem, and before that, you're totally safe. Science doesn't give us that info because there's a fair amount of variability. But what seems consistent is that as the amount and frequency of consumption of animal products rises, the risk of disease also rises. So that's why nutrition scientists are generally in agreement in recommending whole plants. Now, some people will go all the way and be 100% plant-based, be plant-exclusive. Others will have a lot of unprocessed plants and will have some animal products here and there. That's your call. What's important is that you try to get the bulk of your nutrients and the bulk of your calories from whole plants. So that podcast I recently did covered this topic as well. We talked about this for like 20 or 30 minutes. Bottom line is, the associations are a concern because they consistently point in the same direction. But the main problem is that all types of science, all types of experiment, both association type and intervention type, point in the same general direction. So the general picture is pretty clear, which is why the recommendations are so consistent to favor fruits and vegetables and legumes and whole grains, and go easy on the saturated fat and the cholesterol and the ultra-processed foods. I hear this one all the time, so I actually made a bunch of videos covering this in detail. Now, the good news is it's exactly what we've been talking about. Go easy on the saturated fat and the cholesterol and some of the heavily processed foods, and your cholesterol will come down. That's it in a nutshell, basically. There are a couple more tricks and nuances, and you can check out the videos if you want more detail. All right, hope that helps. Let me know if you have other questions that I didn't get to. Write them down below, and maybe I'll do another one of these in the future. That's it for today. I'll see you on the next one.